So our goal for today is to talk about implicit differentiation. What have we been doing so far? We've been doing explicit differentiation. What's the difference? Well, really it boils down to how do we understand the function? See, so far we've had our functions where we say we put our input in, there's a machine, and out comes our output. In other words, we've had this definite machine, a rule, where we clearly know what's happening to our variables. Now the implicit is we don't have our machine. In other words, there is something there, but it's become a mysterious box which we don't understand. And so we don't quite understand how to directly apply the rules for differentiation. Nevertheless, there are variables. The inputs and outputs are still connected. There's still something in the middle. And our goal is to say, how can we figure out how one variable, our output, is changing with another, our input? Well, let's get into it. So the way we should be thinking about explicit functions, because they're the ones we're more familiar with, is that really we have y equals stuff with x. And so there's a mechanical rule. So it's really easy to write an explicit function because they're the kind of functions we're used to. Now you can have really exotic functions or really simple functions. You know, e to the x plus sine of x plus cosine of x cubed plus tangent x, okay? Sure, it's a very strange looking function, but you'll notice that over here, what do we have? It's all x's all the time. So you give me a value for x, and I can grind through and figure out, okay, here's what y needs to be. Now, what's the difference? Well, an implicit relationship says you're not going to be able to get the y by itself. So what you have is you still have a relationship, which is this equality here, where you have stuff with x and y equals other stuff with x and y. Of course, stuff being the mathematical correct term for stuff, right? You know, so what's an example? Well, an example, we can make stuff up. You can say, well, y squared plus cosine of y plus x is equal to e to the x plus y plus 17, or something like that. You know, we can make up all sorts of stuff. And so, lo and behold, there's this relationship. Try as you might, you cannot solve for y. Why can't you solve for y? Well, not because you're not good. Of course you're good. You're great. But notice, you have y's are in various locations. And they're trapped. See, this y here is trapped inside the cosine. How do you get that out of the cosine? Well, you could say, well, apply the arc cosine. But if you free this y, you trap that y. And therefore, you're never going to be able to get y by itself. What about x? Well, same scenario is happening with x. It's just they're different locations. See, there's an x here on the outside. There's also an x inside the exponential function. And again, if I were to free this x, the only way I could do it is to use a log. That would trap that x. So there's no way to algebraically systematically solve for x as a function of y or for y as a function of x. Nevertheless, what's true is if you give me information about x or if you give me information about y, that forces the other variable to obey certain things. It has to usually be one value or maybe a small number of values. And therefore, it's not arbitrary, which means that as you change x, you can also ask what happens to the change in y. And therefore, it's a good question to ask, how does one variable change with respect to the other? Or in other words, what's the derivative here? So that's our goal, understanding the derivative. Now, we will need one idea, and it's such an obvious idea that we haven't explicitly stated it. So we're going to explicitly state it now. And what does it say? It says, hey, if I have two functions which are equal to each other, then their derivatives are equal. And this sort of seems completely obvious, but still, it's a true thing. In fact, we've been using this implicitly several times. And the way that we often use it, we say, hey, let's take our complicated looking expression and simplify it. And now, instead of taking the derivative of the complicated thing, I can take the derivative of the simple thing. But of course, I'm taking the derivative of the same thing, so the answer doesn't change. So What's an example of how you might use this? Well, here's a very simple thing, not necessarily a direct application, but just to show it in action. So we can have a moment here. So you can imagine, start with something like, say, sine squared x plus cosine squared x equals 1. So in other words, over here is my f of x, and over here is my g of x. All right, well, what's true? Well, take the derivative. What do you get? Well, the derivative of sine squared by the chain rule, 2 sine of x to the 1 times the derivative of sine, which is cosine of x, plus chain rule here, 2 cosine of x to the 1 times the derivative of cosine, which is negative sine. Now, that's the derivative if we take the left-hand side. If we take the derivative of the right-hand side, the derivative of 1, and yes, 1 is a function of x. It's not a very interesting function of x, but it is a function. And we get 0. Is it true? Well, yeah, see? Because look what you have. You have 2 cosine x sine x. And you notice there's a little minus there. So you get cancellation. So yeah, it's true. 0 does equal 0. Now, how do we use the fact that if two things are equal, their derivatives are equal to help us solve our problem of implicit differentiation? Well, it's really quite simple at the heart of it. See, what we do is we look at our relationship and we say, well, you know, I don't actually know what the relationship is, but we have sort of a thought. And that is, we're going to think of y as being a function of x. So this is how it goes. We're going to be thinking, I have an idea. Even though I don't know what the right relationship is between y and x, in other words, I don't know the explicit function, I'm going to pretend like there is one. And then I'm going to proceed like normal. In other words, I'll take the derivative of everything with respect to x, and life is good. So what happens? Well, suppose you start with something like x squared plus y squared equals 25. What we say is, okay, is this a function? Y is a function of x. Let's actually answer that question before we go too far. So if I have x squared plus y squared equals 25, now that's not just any curve. We know what that curve is. The curve, it's a circle. So I have a circle. It's actually a circle of radius 5, but that's okay. All we need is a circle. Can y be a function of x, and why not? The answer is no, it can't. The reason is there's something called a vertical line test. And so you'll see, I can draw a vertical line, and lo and behold, it hits in two places. So there is no way to write y as a function of x. So that's one way that we mean that, you know, there's this sort of inability to write y as a function of x. So you might be saying, hold on, we know it is literally impossible for y to be a function of x. Why do we still think of it that way? We'll come back to that in just a second. I want to answer that question, but let's proceed now. Say, okay, so let's suppose that we do have y is some function of x. So if we do, we'll say, okay, then you have x squared plus y of x squared equals 25. Now notice, what do you have? You have some function which involves x equals some other function which involves x. Therefore, take the derivative of both sides, derivative of x squared, 2x, that's pretty straightforward. Derivative of y of x squared, well, now you take the chain rule, right? 2 comes down, y of x to the 1, times the derivative of the inside. And the derivative of y with respect to x, we write dy dx. So we get dy dx. Okay, so that's the derivative of the left-hand side. That has to equal the derivative of the right-hand side, which is 0. And now we say, aha, we have this dy dx, that's what we're after. So we can say dy dx, we subtract 2x and divide by this 2y of x, and simplify, we get it as negative x over y. Now, here's the thing is, when we're actually doing this, you see our little thought bubble? We're thinking of y as a function of x. In practice, so in other words, while we're doing this, we're not going to be writing down y of x. We're just going to be thinking of y as being a function of x. So that's the key, is we got to think of y as a function of x. All right. Well, that's the idea, right? It's a simple idea. Now, I said I'd come back to this, and you might say, I know that I can't have y be a function of x, because there are situations like this circle. Why is this still justified? Well, what we can actually say is that locally, I can treat y as a function of x. So in other words, if I'm near this point, then there is some function, y equals y of x, which behaves like this curve. In fact, for circles, it's actually not so hard to find this function. So for example, on this circle, we'd have y equals the square root of 25 minus x squared would be the top half, and y equals minus the square root of 25 minus x squared is the bottom half. So the point is that there is some function on any point on the curve that locally is behaving like the curve. Now, I suppose we should check for, just on our picture here, does this make sense? Well, we can test a couple of roughly points and say, let's just spot check. Suppose I look at this point here on the circle. What can we say about the slope of the tangent line? What should it be? It should be zero, right? Well, notice, what's the x-coordinate? It's at zero. And lo and behold, you get zero, and the y-coordinate is five, but you get zero or five, which is zero. Aha, see, works. True at one point. It's actually true at every point. It's true at every point. All right, so again, big idea is we see our function. We say, hey, look, there's y. So y really depends on x. We don't actually know how it does, but we're going to treat it like it does. In our mind, we're going to think of it that way. Take the derivative of everything with respect to x, and remember, whenever you take the derivative of y with respect to x, you write down dy dx, or if you prefer, you can write y prime, whichever way is easier for you. But you always need to remember that there's this chain rule going into effect, and you got to account for that. It's important. If you forget it, uh-oh, trouble lies ahead, and we don't want that. All right, so to recap, yes, as we just said, make sure you take the derivative of both sides with respect to one of the variables. Now, you might say, what do you mean with one of the variables? Well, it depends what we call our variables. It don't have to be y and x. We could have s and t, r and theta. We just have to figure out, you know, what derivative are we taking. Now, how do you know which variable to take the derivative with respect to? It oftentimes will be very explicit. For example, if you see something that says, find dy dx, the way you know which variable you're taking the derivative with respect to is you look downstairs and you say, well, what's down here? Whatever variable the name is in the denominator, in this case it's the x, that's the variable that you're taking the derivative with respect to. Be careful, make sure you apply the chain rule correctly, in particular whenever you're taking, say, the derivative of y with respect to x, don't forget that there's a dy dx. And after you take the derivative of both sides, then comes the algebra. And what does that mean? Well, you have to rearrange and solve for your desired derivative. Now, sometimes you're going to solve for a derivative at a point. So for instance, you might be after a tangent line, which means that you also have to do an evaluation. So the question becomes, well, which comes first? Do you evaluate first or do you rearrange first? And the answer is, it ultimately doesn't matter. You'll come up with the same answer. But here's my suggestion. Try to evaluate as soon as possible. Because if you evaluate as soon as possible, then you get to start working with numbers. And oftentimes, it's a lot easier to do things like combine numbers together than it is to combine various bits and pieces of functions. So if you have to choose between doing an evaluation or doing some algebra rearrangement, pick to evaluate first. That's just a good rule of thumb to live by. Now, we were talking about the first derivative. You can, of course, find higher order derivatives because you can say, well, what's the second derivative? And there's a reason why you might be interested in the second derivative, or the third or fourth. But usually, by the time you hit the second derivative, we're like, okay, we know it's possible, and we're satisfied. And the way you do that is you just keep taking derivatives. So if I'm looking for the second derivative, say, for example, here, see how it says d squared y dx squared? That says take two derivatives with respect to x. So what I do is I take the first derivative with respect to x, and then I have a new relationship, something equals something, and I take derivative with respect to x in that relationship, and I get a new relationship. And it might be the case that I have some sort of extra flotsam floating around. So in particular, when I'm looking for the second derivative, I might have some dy dx terms showing up, and I come from the first relationship where I had that dy dx to plug in and simplify. So I can get it all in terms of only y and x. So that's where you see this might need to carry out proper substitution. Some notation, just so you're familiar. We've talked about this line before. Whenever you see this vertical line, that means you're evaluating. So when we're doing implicit differentiation, we oftentimes don't say evaluate at x equals something, because we really need to specify both x and y, because it's potential that there might be multiple values of y associated with a single x for that implicit function. So what do you mean here? So this says take the derivative of y with respect to x and evaluate at a, b. So plug in x equals a, y equals b. And then one last notational note. I think we may have mentioned this before in practice. And of course, I know you watch all the practice because you're a good student. Thank you for working so hard. But you might run into what's called a normal line. And so what is that? Well, you can imagine you have some implicitly defined curve. Say this is our implicitly defined curve here. And so a normal line, well, let's start with what we know. A tangent line touches a curve. So a tangent line has some curve like this. So I have my point where I'm passing through. The normal line will be perpendicular to the curve. And in particular, the normal line is perpendicular to the tangent line. So essentially, the normal line, you're thinking of crossing the curve in a perpendicular way. So that's what a normal line is. And as a reminder, how do we know if two curves are perpendicular? The slopes are negative reciprocals. All right. Well, so now we have an idea. Now we know what to do with implicit differentiation. Take the derivative of both sides with respect to the right variable and simplify, simplify, simplify. All right. Well, good. I think maybe it's time for us to start doing some practice. So have a good day. Have fun.